Hello friends, I am Sanjay Gupta. I welcome you on Sanjay Gupta Tech School. In this video, I am going to explain how we can write algorithms. So if you watched my previous video, that was also related to how we can write algorithms. So in that video, I explained you the way through which we can write algorithms. But in this video, I will be telling you another way also. So a problem can be implemented in two different ways. That looks like an algorithm. So in this video, you will learn another way as well. So in my previous video, I explained you how to write sequential algorithms. So right now I am taking an example of swapping. So at the end of that video, I gave you five problems. So from those five problems, this is one of the problems that I'm going to solve. So let me write the first way or method of implementing algorithm. So here, step one, begin. Then step number two, read values of A and B. Then step number three. So from step number three, 4 and 5, I am going to write the logic for swapping. So here, set C equals to A. Sorry, set C equals to A. Then step number 4 will be set A equals to B. And step number 5 will be set B equals to C. So these are simple swapping steps that you might have learned in C language as well. So after this swapping operation, I can write print values of A and B, right? So after swapping, whatever values are available in A and B variables will be printed, and then I can end this algorithm. So this is first way that I also explained in my previous video. Now in this video, you will learn the another way of writing this algorithm. So here you can see, input is provided by user, then process is applied and output is displayed, right? Now, in real-time scenarios, whenever we will be implementing some problems through our programming language, so there will be various functions available, right? So this algorithm can be implemented similar to a function loop, where input will be not received from the user, it will be passed by another function, right? So you can write it like this. So you need to assume that the input values will be available into these variables. And after this header, you need to write the steps. So here you can directly write set C equals to A. So now you can compare it. So in this way, we use step number as begin and step number two as read values of A and B. Those are not available here. So you can imagine it is a part of a complete process. And name of this process is swap, and it is receiving two values as input. So don't write read statement here, because A and B are already having values. Then step number two will be set A equals to B. Step number three will be set B equals to C. So these are simple swapping statements. Now in step number four, I can write print values of A and B, and then we can end this algorithm, right? So these are two different ways through which you can implement any algorithm. So first method is very simple, and second method is similar to a user defined function. So if you are going to implement this algorithm in C programming, so you need to implement swap function separately, and you need to implement main function separately, and main function will be calling the swap function and passing the parameters into these variables. And if we talk about this, so here you don't need to implement any separate function. Whole steps can be implemented through main function, right? So in my upcoming videos, those will be related to array, linked list, and any other algorithm. So you will see this header always, because that process can be called by any other method. So that's why I will be using these approach in those videos, right? So this was first way. Now, sorry, this was first type. So now I'm going to explain second type. So second type was decision-making algorithms. So I'm erasing these. So here, second type is decision-making algorithms, right? And the process will be even or odd. So this is the problem for which we need to implement the algorithm. So again, I'm going to implement two different ways. First will be having all the steps from begin to end, and second will look like a sub method. So here, step number one is begin. Then step number two, read value of n. So here you can see we need to check even or odd. So we need only one number. So I'm going to read that number into n variable. Then here I am applying if. So n mod 2 equals to 0. Right. So I'm writing mod here because I can't use modulus operator, because that might be available in any programming language or any other symbol will be used. So I'm just writing mod. So n mod 2, if its remainder will be equals to 0, then I can write print, and inside double quotes I'm writing even. Then else I'm writing print or. And also you can write end of if. So this is optional. If you want to write end of if, then you can use it. Otherwise you can also remove it. And step number four will be end. So this is these are simple steps starting from begin to end. Now how we can write it like so that it will be having a function like look. So you can write even or as its name, then n, then here you can write step number one. So now you don't need to write the statement read value of n. You can directly use these steps here. You can directly use these steps here. So now I'm writing if n mod 2 equals to 0. So I can write print. Inside double quotes, I am writing even, then else, print odd, then end of if, and step number two will be end. So this way you can write function like algorithm. So I hope you understood, because both are very simple. Only changes, we are not reading values from user. In this, we are assuming that a value will be available into this n variable, because this sub process will be called by another process while implementing in a programming language. So this was a second type of algorithm, that is decision making algorithm. Now I'm coming on to third type. Third type is iterative algorithm. So I'm erasing these. So third type is iterative algorithm, and problem is calculate factorial. So first I'm going to implement this easy way, and then I'm going to implement the function like way for this problem, right? So step number one, begin, then step number two, read value of n. Again, we need only one input, because we need to calculate factorial of a particular number. So that will be available in n. Now in third stack, I am writing set I equals to 1. So this will be loop counter, which is starting from 1. And after comma, I am writing f equals to 1. So this will be the variable in which factorial will be stored. So I and f both are initialized with 1. After this, I am writing repeat. So it is responsible for repeating some set of steps. So repeat steps. So here I am going to write which steps I am going to repeat. And while I less than equals to n. So this is the condition, right? So you can write step numbers here after completion of these steps, because you don't know how many steps will be repeating with this step. So leave it blank, and after writing these, you can put steps number here. So step number 5 will be f equals to f into I. And step number 6 will be, so here you can also write set I equals to I plus 1, right? So these are the steps, then end of loop. So this is also optional. This indicates that loop is starting from fourth step and it is ending after sixth step. So now you can write step number 5 and 6. So you can read this, repeat steps 5 and 6 while I is less than equal to. Right. So this way we implemented this algorithm. Now after completion of this loop, at step number 7, I can write print value of f, which is containing factorial, and step number 8 will be n. So this way I implemented iterative algorithm through first method. Now we can convert this algorithm into function-like algorithm, right? So what I need to do, I need to remove these from the top. So I am not going to read input from the user. I am assuming that this method will be called by another method, and that method will be providing the value. So here I am writing factorial, and inside bracket I am writing n. And this will be step number 1, 2, 3, step number 4, 5 and 6. And we are going to repeat step number 3 and step number 4. So this way, this is the algorithm, and this is the correct form that we are going to use to understand array, linked list, stack queues. Those are available in data structures. So I hope you understood all three types of algorithm writing now. So first was sequence algorithm. Second was decision making, and third is iterative algorithm. And I explained you all three types or type of algorithm with two different methods. One is having input, processor, output, all the steps, and another one is similar to a sub method which don't receive input from user, which receives input from the method which is calling that sub algorithm or method, right? And overall process will be same in both the methods. So remember, we are going to use this second method that we discussed in this video in future to understand various concepts of data structure and algorithm. So I hope you understood whatever I explained in this video. So keep watching videos related to data structure so that you can prepare the subject for your studies. Thank you for watching this video.